Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome, morning. Welcome, beautiful Savannah, Georgia. It's good. Hope you've had a good week. We've enjoyed the bit of rain that we've had. Need more, but we are thankful for what we've got. Want to tell you about a few things coming up this next week that you may want to be a part of. First of all, this next week, it is the week leading up to the July 4th holiday, and on July the 2nd, our James Barnes has made it possible for us to be able to do some service. So on Friday, if you have time, we're going to be helping to serve the emergency room workers at Memorial Health University's ER. So if you want to plug into that, please talk to James. He'll give you the details. But that's coming up, and if you can't be a part of that, I encourage you to be praying. Who knows what God will do with that, okay? It's a matter of faithfulness meets God's faithfulness. So if we'll be faithful, God will. We just need to let God use us to love on and serve some folks, and that's a great opportunity. Again, and then next Sunday, we're going to be eating after worship, okay? That thing that we do, a July 4 picnic on the grounds after we worship next week. We are supplying hamburgers and hot dogs. Please bring all those phenomenally creative, wonderful side items, and we will share, and we will probably have more food than we know what to do with. Okay, that's usually what happens. So if you have any questions about that, call Dusty. He'll tell you to bring fried rice, okay? So only if you're good at it, though. Just if you have any questions, let us know. But that's what we have to look forward to. And so now I'm going to turn over to Logan, let him open us in prayer, and we'll get started.
Good morning, everybody. Let's bow our heads for some prayer. Dear God, just thank you for this awesome time of worship with you, Lord. Thank you for getting everybody safe to church this morning, Lord. And thank you that this isn't our only opportunity to be the church, Lord, that we get six other days out of your week to be your church, God. And that's my prayer for us, that we will live out what we speak and hear and receive on Sunday mornings, that we live that out the rest of the week in the workplace, at home, with our families, with strangers at the gas station, God. I pray for next week with this cookout that somebody will just be driving by and just want to stop in, and I want to see what this community is about, and that we can give them a taste of what God has given us here at Sycamore, Lord. And I just thank you for all the opportunities that you're going to bring us through this physical place that we get to meet on, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, I've been at the lake all week, and you would think it would be hard to come home, but I just couldn't wait to get home and worship with you guys. So let's stand and worship, and just let it rip, for lack of a better term. Your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire in darkest night.
You are close like no other, and I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. My life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Amen. Jesus, you're my home. To rise to you when temptation comes my way, and I cannot stand, I fall on you, Jesus, you're my only
worship that was. God, thank you for allowing us to be here to experience worship with one another, Lord. I thank you for giving us music that ultimately can get some to worshiping you, God. I thank you for blessing me with being able to look out and see the faces of just innocence and laying it down for you in their time of worship. God, may we feel blessed as we leave here and be blessed throughout our week, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning again. Welcome to those of you who are joining us today online. Thank you. We want you to know that you're important to us, and we're praying for you. And especially if you have things that are on your heart that we need to be sharing with you in terms of carrying the burden, please let us know. Send us an email. Send us a text. And we'll be happy to do that. Pastors get together and pray on Mondays together. We have cards that are here in the chairs. If you happen to have a prayer request, that's what those cards are for. Let us know how we can pray with you and be with you in this time. So thank you for being with us. Whenever I was a kid growing up, my grandfather Borman would spend time with me whenever I would see him. We'd either go to Arkansas. He lived in Stuttgart, Arkansas, which is the rice capital and duck capital of the world, pretty much. At least that's the way it's been promoted to me all my life. Or he would come to see us whenever I was growing up in Atlanta. My grandfather would always get time with me. And when we had time together one-on-one, he would talk to me about Jesus. I'm going to be honest with you, I was extremely uncomfortable. Because he was talking about something I didn't quite get. See, I understood church. I got church, okay? And I kind of knew in general how to do the church thing and what all the stories were. But when he started talking to me about a faith in a person and how that would change me, that at that time, that was just something I wasn't very comfortable with, quite frankly, to be honest. But my grandfather loved me. And he, every time we would see one another, he would make sure that he had that conversation with me. I knew it was coming, okay? But he did it anyway. He was not necessarily the evangelistic type. He was just a farmer, a rice farmer. But he had a great deep desire for his family to know Jesus and to serve God. And if you look at his life, you can see that there's fruit from that. He had three children. My mom was his oldest. She had three children. You know me, my brother lives in Rome, my sister lives in Birmingham, and all of us now are disciples of Jesus. Okay? He also had two sons. One is a missionary. He's lived in Italy most of his life and still lives there now. And my other uncle, Stuttgart, farmer and pastor. So what do you think was the fruit of that deep desire that he had, that those that were closest to him would come to faith in Jesus? What was his motivation? Today we're going to talk a little bit about motivation. Our motivation to make disciples of Jesus as we are going. And you know, I've told you over and over and over again, that Great Commission, it begins with that statement. Not just go in terms of an imperative, but as you're going, while you're doing it, whether you're going to Walmart, whether you're going to Nigeria, as you're going, make disciples. You know, God didn't rescue us or restore us, which is what we've been talking about as we've looked at the first four chapters and the second four chapters in the book of Romans. He didn't rescue us and restore us so we could feel good about ourselves. Unfortunately, a lot of us have got that all tangled up. The gospel is not about self-help or spiritual well-being, okay? It's often preached that way in America, unfortunately, that it's all about us. But truth is, each one of us has been rescued and restored for a purpose. And that purpose is that we were brought into God's family to be a part of the family business. And that family business has a plan. And that's God's mission. God's mission to redeem the world. That's you and me. So I want to look at that diagram that we've been talking about as we've looked at the book of Romans so far. We've discussed in Romans chapter 1 through 4 the focus on the fact that God was bringing us and others into His kingdom and rescuing us from where we were. Certainly, that's what my grandfather was doing whenever I was a kid. He was trying to put his hand out, and I kept saying, I'm just not comfortable enough to grab that hand. He rescued us. God rescued us. And then once He did that, He had to develop us, build us. And last week, whenever we talked about chapter 8, talked about the fact that last treasure that God gives us, the treasure of the Holy Spirit, it transforms us and makes us God's children. And in doing that, He didn't just build us, He restored us to what He intended for us to be in the very beginning. So the Holy Spirit had a very important role in that. And today we talk about this third quadrant here, where we talk about us being the rescuer and about God sending us, moving us out to where we are the ones who go into the world. So today I want to first talk about the heart, the motivation that leads us to make disciples. And I want to begin with a story. This story is about a guy named John Gordon that I went to college with. Call him John Gordon because that's his name. John and I played baseball together at Wofford. We were both freshmen. We were not alike hardly in any way whatsoever, other than the fact that we both played baseball. I'm 5'3", stocky, and white as can be. John was slender, tall, African-American, and a great fluid athlete. He came from South Carolina, I came from Georgia. As far as I was concerned, that meant he was from the country and I was from the city because I was from Atlanta. Very, very different. We both went through a whole lot of things our freshman year. Both of us struggled through that freshman year playing baseball. It was rough. In the summer, after our freshman year, I went home and I worked tearing down auto parts somewhere between the Atlanta Federal Pen and Grant Park Zoo. And John went to New York. Some of you will understand this reference when I make it. He went to work for the Southwestern Book Company. And the Southwestern Book Company in those days was known for hiring college students during the summer and sending them all over the country to sell encyclopedias and Bibles door to door, which was kind of ironic. Because John, at that point, was really not very interested in the things of God. But John went to New York, and God proceeded to make him absolutely miserable. He was in New York. He was from South Carolina. He was trying to sell Bibles to New Yorkers. encyclopedias. They don't need those in New York either. So John was really struggling and miserable, and he was just out beside himself. And so one day, he was so lonely, so frustrated because he couldn't sell either one of those things. He was walking on the street and walked by an open door. And in that open door, he heard music. He heard people singing about Jesus. He heard people speaking about Jesus. And he was so miserable that he walked in the door. And when he did, things began to change. John began to be discipled by the little old ladies that were in that room, in that place. And when John came back to Spartanburg, South Carolina, John was not the same kind of John. Now, he wasn't perfect and I wasn't perfect. Both of us were growing in our faith at the time, and none of us were perfect in that. But he was a different John. Now, I tell you that story because I want to lead into this. The fact of the matter is, we don't see it and we don't understand, but God is always doing things that we can't see. He is at work all the time. God made John miserable in New York City. So he would walk in a door. That he would, if he had tried to walk, he would never have walked in that door in Spartanburg, because he had a lot of other doors he could have walked through to Jesus in Spartanburg, South Carolina, that would have been a whole lot more comfortable and a whole lot more welcoming. But that's not what God did. God was at work in John. God was at work in those little old ladies in New York. And wham, God hit John over the head with a spiritual 2x4. And John came to faith in Jesus. I'll tell you that story because we need to talk about this. Look at Romans chapter 9, verses 16 and 17. I'm looking at English Standard Version. So then, this is what Paul wrote. He said, "So then it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy." And then he goes on to talk about Pharaoh and how Pharaoh glorified God even though Pharaoh was a knucklehead and did everything he could to keep Israel from leaving Egypt. God was at work. He was even using Pharaoh to draw his people to himself. It's foundational. Something we've got to understand, that God is at work tirelessly, creatively, purposefully. And he intends to redeem the world. And you or I are smack dab in the middle of that story. Whether we want to be or not, we are, some way or another. Now, last week you heard me talk about the movie that George Peppard was in. What's So Bad About Feeling Good? Okay, it's a cute movie. Well, this week I've got another George Peppard thing I want to share with you. He was a part of a TV show that some of you who are my age or maybe a little younger might remember, the A-Team. And he was the lead character. He was Hannibal Smith, another Smith. And one of the lines that Hannibal Smith came to be associated with was, "I love it when a plan comes together." Well, that's what I'm telling you, is that if we'll understand that God is at work drawing people to himself all around us all the time, if we will just have that vision, we'll love it when God calls that plan and it comes together. And we see it, because the fact of the matter is, it really is. It's just a matter of, are we seeing it or are we not seeing it? Are we a part of it or are we acting like a spectator? So what moves us to make disciples? What motivates us? What drives us out as he sends us? Let's look at something else Paul said in chapter 9. Here we're going to go to verse number 3, back at the beginning of the chapter. He says, "For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my brothers, my kinsmen, according to the flesh." Now, this is a statement that demonstrates that Paul had a great passion for those who were the closest to him. He grew up in the middle of Jewish life. He was a Pharisee of Pharisees. And he knew these people. And yet he had this great desire, this passion, that they would come to understand that Jesus was the Messiah. He even says here that he would go to the extreme that he himself would be fine with being removed from God's presence if his people would come to know Jesus as Messiah. That's quite a passion. It's the same kind of passion that Jesus had for us when he died on the cross. You know, when I was growing up, when I first came to faith in Jesus, I was in college, and my brother was still in high school, and I can remember the evenings when my brother would come home from whatever he had been doing, and we would be talking in the kitchen. I was trying to talk to him about why listening to God's voice, why opening his heart to the fact that Jesus might be able to do something in his life. I remember him sitting on the counter in the corner, and I remember for like 45 minutes to an hour at a time just talking to him, having that desire that my brother would come to faith in Jesus. Now the cool, then I remember my sister, who was a senior in high school my first year back when I went to my, you understand, I went back to my alma mater after college and taught for about 3 years. And my sister, my first year, she was a senior my first year back. A little different. And I remember going and talking to her and spending time with her because she too was struggling through those teenage things in life and talking to her about how Jesus had an answer for her. Now, I didn't have a hand, literally, in the day that either one of them decided that they were going to be a disciple of Jesus. But they both are. God's working in their lives. They're blessed for it. They're part of his purpose and his plan. And it's been wonderful to see. I had a desire that those closest to me would come to faith in Jesus. I had that same desire for Luke and Abby as they were growing up. And you all played, many of you played a part in what they understand about Jesus. Because they lived among you and you were their uncles and aunts and friends and cousins and all that kind of stuff. Thank you, Pascal's family, for being my son's second home much of his high school years. I pray for people that I care about now that are close to me. I try to talk to them as much as I can whenever God gives me opportunity. But what about people who are not close to us? People who we only occasionally cross paths with, or we cross paths with every once in a while. What's our motivation to make them disciples? If passion is what the motivation is for those who are closest to us, what is it for those who are not? So let's go to Romans chapter 9 here, verses 25 and 26. Here, Paul refers to a passage from Hosea. He says, as indeed he says in Hosea, and this is talking about God's voice, those who are not my people, I will call my people. And her who is not beloved, I will call beloved. And in the very place where it was said to them, you are not my people, they will be called sons of the living God. What's he talking about? He's talking about God's compassion on those who need compassion. So we need to have compassion for those that we encounter who may be different from us. It may be that they're not in the same line of work. It may be that they're from somewhere else in the country. It may be that they're different ethnicity. It may be they're wealthy and we're poor, or they're poor and we're wealthy. Whatever we can come up with that would be a difference. The fact of the matter is, compassion is what drives us to try to be the hands and feet of Jesus to them, and to share with them that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And that's what we were made to do. Made to be a part of that family business. You know, Gentiles were not like Jews. They did not worship the one true God. They often had many gods. They did abominable things in their worship or whatever they worshiped. They many times mistreated people. You think about all of that. And Gentiles, they were very strict. They had certain rules. They lived their lives a certain way. They had a particular way of worshiping God that was unique in their world. Now, the fact of the matter is, we encounter all these people who are very, very different from us. And we have more access now to people who are different from us than we've ever had in any time on the planet, if you can think about it. Okay, I can get on the internet and I can encounter countless numbers of people who are different from me in a moment. So whenever we cross paths with people, we need to understand that there is no mistake. God is at work. He's at work now. He'll be at work when you and I go to lunch. And there are people out there who are doing what they do. We need to understand and embrace the fact that it's compassion when we are there, as we understand that God is at work and there's somebody for me to love and care for where I go. And I can share with them. And my motivation is that I care and that I understand who they are, where they're coming from, what's going on in their lives. So what's the bridge? If compassion is our motivation, what's the bridge between them and us? If we're different, what is it that is the thing that connects us to one another? That's what I want to talk about now. In Romans chapter 9, verse 33, it's simple. God's talking about a fact. It says, "Behold, I am laying in Zion a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, and whoever believes in him," and that him is clear, he's talking about in this Jesus, "will not be put to shame." Every one of us, every single one of us, all people need God to remove their shame. It's something that's similar across cultures, cross experiences, cross ethnicities, whatever barriers you got, everybody needs God to remove their shame. Every one of us has things that we don't want anybody to know. We would rather people not know. I remember whenever I was in college again, one of the other guys that I played baseball with, our fathers worked together, knew each other. My dad was professor, his dad was professor. His dad was at Georgia, my dad was at Georgia State. But they knew each other and worked with one another. And somehow, at some time, my dad told me something that was not very good about his dad. And for some stupid reason, I don't know to this day, I can't remember what the reason was, but I decided that I was going to share that stupid thing with the other guys that I knew at school. To this day, I'm not proud of that. Now, I was ashamed of that. Should be, because I should never have said anything. It wasn't mine to share. But God has removed my shame. I can tell the story. Each of us has felt shame. We did things that we don't want anybody to know. But God does not want to shame us. That's not God's purpose. Instead, he wants to reclaim us. And that's why he has sent us out. Why he's put passion and compassion in our hearts so that we would go out as we are going, as it says in the Great Commission, to make disciples and to communicate to people that their shame can be removed. And that's something that God wants to do through Jesus, through faith in the Son of God. You know, one of the things we have to do is we have to listen to these folks. We can't just preach at people. We have to listen to them. We have to find time to carefully listen, carefully enough, prayerfully enough, and long enough so that in God's time the bridge becomes clear. And the message of Jesus, it deals with people's shame because it touches on and deals with removing people's sin. It's a simple message. What's the message? So in Romans chapter 9, verses 30 through 32, Paul says this. He says, "What shall we say then? That Gentiles," that's you and me folks, we're here because this is true, "who did not pursue righteousness have attained it. That is, a righteousness that is by faith. But that Israel, who pursued a law that would lead to righteousness, did not succeed in reaching that law." Why? Because they did not pursue it by faith, but as if it were based on works. Faith is the key, folks. From the time of Abraham to us, it's always been Faith in God builds the relationship. It's never been works. It's never been do good things, be a good person. It's all be a citizen. Which, hey, folks, I'm telling you, we are living in a culture that wants to change and substitute the fact that we are supposed to be having faith in Jesus with we need to produce good citizens. And I'm telling you, the purpose of the church is not to create good citizens. It is not to make our children good people, as much as it would be nice if they were. It's that they come to faith in Jesus and be changed, transformed. So the message that we have is not a message about church. I love Sycamore Church. I would encourage anybody who's not living in Savannah, you come to Savannah to visit, come to Sycamore Church, because this is an awesome, great, great place. It's people of God. We share life. It's a wonderful, wonderful experience. Been here, oh, I can't remember now, what, 17 years? Decided not to leave? But what we preach is Jesus. What we preach is the kingdom of God. It's not this building. It's not even this gathering of people. It is Jesus. Come be a part of Jesus. So what we preach is Christ born of a virgin. What we preach is live sinless on the face of the planet. Lived as the Son of the living God. Demonstrated that in what he said and what he did. And then whenever people decided to hang him on a cross to crucify him, it was because he said he was the Son of God. He didn't do anything wrong. And then he said he would come back in 3 days, he would take up his life again, and after he was dead, he did. And then after that, he said he would send his Holy Spirit, and he did. And so today we are here because of that. This is the message that we have to share. God intends to remove our shame. He intends to make even more people a part of the family business. And so that's our job. That's who we are. So let me look at this in sort of a way of questioning. The things that we've talked about today. The first question I have for you is, who are those closest to you who do not know Jesus? It matters. Second question. Who crosses your path that does not know Jesus? Who do you know you're going to see sometime during this week and you know they don't know Jesus? Third question is, have you listened to them lately? You can't find out where God is at work in their lives if you don't shut up and listen. Sometimes we believers, we think we got so much to say, and really what we need to be doing is listening. Find out what's going on with people. And then just show them. Show them simply how God wants to remove their shame. Do you believe that God is at work all around you right now? And are you praying? How are you praying about all these things? Are you praying about those that you have a passion for? Are you praying that God would grow the compassion within you for people who are not like you? And that he would give you the opportunity to share with people you encounter that you might not know real well. Today's the day that we realize the family business is for us. And that the motivation, it's a matter of us letting God grow. I don't know, you guys remember the Grinch Who Stole Christmas? Remember that last picture in the Grinch Who Stole Christmas? Where they show the Grinch's heart gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. Well, if that's what God has to do in us so that we have the motivation to be about the family business, let's let that be our prayer. So let's pray. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for speaking. Lord, I pray that you would grow our hearts, that, Lord, our passion for those closest to us and our compassion for those who cross our paths, maybe who are different from us, that, Lord, you will allow us to have the patience and the prayerful endurance and the desire to share life with people so that, Lord, we will have the opportunity to tell them that you have sent your Son to remove their shame. Lord, let us see this as truly good news and see it happen as we try to grow your kingdom one life at a time. Thank you for calling us to the family business. We ask this and we dedicate it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Yay!